Good morning, students. Hello and welcome to Abhiyan IAS Academy. Today, we'll be dealing with the second part of Growth of English in India. In the last class, we had done with Raja Ram Mohan Roy's letter of 1823 to Lord Amherst, where he was talking in 1823 letter, in which he was telling Lord Amherst that the Indians could not learn anything new if they were getting educated in the same Sanskrit and the Persian and language and also Urdu, because they had already been learning in that language for the last 2,000-3,000 years. So he had suggested to Lord Amherst that the schools and colleges which they had thought of establishing in India should be English medium schools. And following that line, in 1835, we will have the infamous Macaulay's Minute. That was called the Bill on Education. This is even till date one of the most significant moment in India's education. And what happened in Macaulay's education was, in Lord Macaulay had suggested that that they were trying to create a class of Indians which would just be Indians in color, but in blood they would be completely English. So what they were trying to create was a class of babus, or the interpreters, like interpreters and the clerical class, who would be helping them to organize their rule in India better, who would help them to understand the aspirations, needs of the people, so that they could make rules and policies in order to govern this country more according to their will. So Lord Macaulay is also famous for saying certain infamous statements, as I had also said in my last lecture, like saying that one library of the West can hold the entire knowledge of the East. So he was someone who was an extreme evangelist, and these were the things he had said. So along with those, we'll also concentrate on a few important dates and events, like in 1837. 1837 is a trademark date, because it was then that English was made an official language in India. We might be getting questions from here that in 1937, English was made the official language of everyday use. In 1944, in 1844, what happened was the office jobs were thrown to Indians. And what happens, because it's just a little while after the Macaulay's Minute, by then they had actually created a class of a few people who could take up the official positions and posts in the office. Remember, not in ranks very high above, but in the ranks where they could never think of going against their English masters. They were just trying to create a group of loyal servants to the British rule. And in 1854, it was declared, it was the first proper educational, this was the East India Company's first education charter for India, or education bill for India, whatever you want to call. That's the, that would be the Woods Dispatch. What the Woods Dispatch did was, Woods Dispatch had talked about a number of things which they thought were important in the Indian education system. Lord Macaulay's Minute remains infamous and very oft quoted. However, the proper educational bill that was drafted happened only in 1854 with Lord Charles Wood. And there it was said, he was Lord Halifax, but there he said that English should be taught in places where there was a demand for it. He did not say that it should be taught to everybody and anybody, but only when there was a need and demand for the language. So with that, the schools that were formed after that, and also the colleges, the English was being taken up as a subject. It also said that the Christian religion would be taught to schools, and they would be taught just like the language only if the students asked for being imparted with the religious education. It also talked about teachers' training, that the quality of the teachers had to improve. It also talked about establishment of universities, and it introduced a system of grant in aids to encourage the private enterprises. And also with this act, we will get the formation of the education department, which would later impact the other next educational bills which would come. So teachers training was one of the teachers training, women's education, education for the other classes, because India was still a country which was terribly divided on basis of class, caste, sections, religion. So all these had to be mentioned separately, that education was supposed to become a part for all of these people. Like the ones, generally education was restricted to the very upper class, bourgeois, suburban males. So that was, the English government was trying to decentralize that, and that it should be set up in a number of other, it should allow not just the men, but also the women, and the people of the lower caste, so that they could, the English had never been discriminating in education and related to caste. That was something that was in essentially the Southeast Asian phenomena that we had. So it was, in one way it was good that it was talking about kind of an inclusive education. So with that, we'll end with the 1854 Act. And so when educational decentralization was talked of, what happened in 1857 was the Calcutta, Bombay and the Madras presidencies were set up. And in 1857, we will also have the Sepoy Mutiny. So there are two important events. Probably we all know about the Sepoy Mutiny, but we do not know that also the three universities of Calcutta, Bombay and Madras were also set up in 1857. So after that, what happened in 1858? This is another trademark moment, not just for the education, but like for entire India. Because in 1858, what happens is the British East India Company is no longer ruling India. And with the Queen's proclamation, India from now on would be governed directly by the Queen of England. From now on, after 1858, whatever happens in related to education or any of the bills, they would be directly signed under the Queen's name and not in the name of the East India Company. So the next part of this would be in, there are a few trademark dates about which we need to remember. That it's 1882, it's Indian Education Commission, which would later on be governing all the rest of the policies to come. And this 1882 commission wasn't a complete formalized restructured thing. It was kind of amateurish, but in 1902 we'll get the better form of that. That's the Indian University Commission. And with that, this Indian University Commission will come and form the 1904 the Universities Act. In the Universities Act, it was said that English would not be taught to the students until and unless they have received a thorough grinding in their own vernacular language. And English would be introduced only after a certain age, preferably not before the age of 13. So even then the English, they were never forcing English as a medium of learning. But what happened was, the idea was jobs were going to people who were educated in English. So with that, since the idea of the official job was thrown to the Indians at around 1844, so what happened is the Indians who were educated in English were getting the jobs in the government offices. And along with that, that increased the idea that Indians should be getting more and more educated in English. So though the English government did not force them to learn English, but it was just, and along with that, so it was just becoming a way of life then. And then in 1912 and 13, a number of the Indian universities were set up. They were the native universities, and they were set up as a result of the Swadeshi, and they were not set up by the British government. And then we will have the National Council of Education in 1906. 1906 will form the national Council of Education, and in 1928 we will have the Hartog Commission. So in 1928 we'll have that, and in 1937 we will have the Abbott report. Okay. So these are the few again trademark dates that we need to remember, and in 1944 we'll have the Sargent report also. That's the last one that we have before independence. All these reports were making a certain recommendations about English, when English should be taught and when it should not. These were talking about all the forms of education, that's in primary, secondary, upper primary, all these forms. And in 1937, we had the Wardha Commission that was talking about an alternative form of education. That talked about the seven-year course of education later on, whose reformed format we will have in the 10+2+3 format, which was again reformed in 2020 with the new educational policy. So we'll take that up later, but for now, in the first 7 years of the education, they were talking about the free and the compulsory mode of education, which was later on taken up in the parliament too, that Indians till the age of 14 should have free and compulsory education. Next would be the medium of the 1937 commission also said that the medium of education should be in their mother tongue, and also it would be accompanied by the productive work, so which in the later days would be called our SUPW, the socially useful productive work. So this was mostly about the commissions and committees that were formed pre-independence. So we'll do a quick recap of whatever we did in the other day, from the coming of the Britishers to India. So after their advent, what happened is the most important, along with also there were certain events like the coming of the missionaries. The missionaries were an important tool of not just spreading the Christianity, of not spreading Christianity in India, but they were also spreading English at the same time. It was working vice versa. The missionaries, they were getting educated in the native languages of India so that they could translate the Bible in those languages and give it to people for a wider reach. There was a Bible society established, in fact, for doing all those. And they were distributing Bibles amongst the people for them to read. So the transfer was not happening just one way, that the missionaries were just talking about religion and Bible in India, but it was also the other way around. They were also learning the language from the munshis which were there, and we have in fact very fascinating books written on them, like how they were reading and learning the vernaculars and what kind of effect was there. And at the same time, in and around Kolkata, in places like Hooghly and Chandanagar and Srirampur, most importantly, the printing press was developed. And with the printing press and the moving typefaces in Bengali, the texts were, there was an, I, the English press had developed a lot before that, but it was very difficult even then to do the typeface, the same thing in Bengali. And then that was their first trial to do things in the Indian typeface. So with that, education, not just education was being spread, but religion was also being spread at the same time. So it was but a two-way process. It was, there was a language, there was a transfer of language, there was also a transfer of the religious ideas. So that is one also very important machinery through which the English were spreading their ideas in India. And in the pre-independent India, there were a number of commissions and committees which were formed, beginning at the East India Company, which had come to India, had come as traders, and slowly and steadily till 1858, and with the Queen's Proclamation, when after the Sepoy Mutiny, they saw that East India Company could no longer really control all of it. So the control was coming under the British government in the British Parliament, which was being ruled in the name of the Queen, the crown, that's the crown. In 1858, this entire thing comes under the British crown. And what happens after that is the British, all the rules and the laws which were previously passed by the East India Company were no longer passed in the name of them, but it was directly controlled by the British government. And the educational acts and policies which were also being formed during this time was signed in the name of the Queen. So what happened is a few of the trademark developments that were happening were the establishment of universities, opening of the jobs for the Indians, and putting English as one of the subjects which should be taken up in the curriculum. But of course, it was not forced on them. It was not forced on the Indian students. It was always said that they should be taught in English whenever they wanted to, except for the very infamous Macaulay's Minute, which said that everything that the West was far, far superior than the East, except for such infamous minutes. And that mostly the other commissions talked about including English as a part of the education only when they had the Indians had learned in their vernacular, and after that they could take up reading in English. But what was happening at the same time was, after the Macaulay's Minute, most of the jobs were going to the English educated Indians, and hence that was creating a class of interpreters and the clerics. Clerical classes. And however, the English had never imagined the fact that with this education they had never thought that the Indians could probably be rising up to competing in something similar to equal with them in the Indian civil services. So that is something they had probably not thought of while they were educating the Indians in English. They had not thought in the same language in which they were teaching the Indians they would also get to know about the ideas of liberty, equality and fraternity. And with the same thing, they would be coming around the British, and that would finally pave the way for the Indian independence. However, that was the trajectory of Indian education, the spread of English in India before the independence. In our next video lecture, we'll talk about the post-India and the committees and the commissions which were formed then, and how English was being taken up in those commissions and committees. That's all for today. Thank you.